So when we looked in the last video, my security overview for a particular website, we noticed it actually wasn't using Diffie-Hellman, it was using Elliptic Curve Diffie-Hellman. So this is just going to be a short video that explains broadly the difference between the two without going into too much maths. Although actually the maths of Elliptic Curves isn't that difficult. Let's not go over Diffie-Hellman a third time. So you and me have some kind of secret key and we use that to talk securely. Diffie-Hellman is how we get that secret key. Every time I talk about Diffie-Hellman and use any kind of analogy, people were like, oh, show us the math. So this is for the maths people. We had a few interesting questions on the Diffie-Hellman video. So let's explore. Remember that Alice here has some public variable g to the power of a mod n. Now what's important about this is that in some sense, A has been mixed into this generator so that we can't split it up. She can send this around without everyone working out what A is, which is the important thing. So really, what the mathematics behind Diffie-Hellman does is allow the protocol to send messages where you can't extract this private variable. And that's exactly what elliptic curves do. They just do it in a slightly different way. I'll draw a picture of an elliptic curve-ish. Right, so this is an elliptic curve. Elliptic curves are curves in two dimensions.
We need colours on this, Mark.
Colours. It's the future. Right, so the formula for an elliptic curve is y squared is x cubed plus ax plus b, and that's the last time we're going to talk about it. So the parameters of the curve are a and b, and then the curve will look something like, hold on, I'm going to sort of take a bit of artistic license with this, but something a bit like that. Now, they vary in shape depending on what a and b are. The thing about an elliptic curve is, in our modular arithmetic, we had numbers going around modulo n, right, which is just a list of numbers, a cycle of numbers. Here we have a cycle of points somewhere on this curve. So our generator will be a point on this curve. Let's use blue, shall we? This is our generator. That's not a good place for my generator. It's not a good place for my generator because then my next example of adding things to the generator won't work. let's do it there. Right, ignore that point. That can be a different point for later. Now, if this is our generator G, what we can do, instead of raising things to powers, we just add G to itself. We have 2G, 3G. 3G is G plus G plus G. Yeah. So what we can do is we can add G to itself. To do that, what you do is you draw a line at the tangent of this curve all the way until it hits another point on the curve. You flip it over to the other dimension, and this is 2G over here. 3G would be the line between these two, find out where it intersects, and flip it over here. So this is 3G. 3G plus G would be, it goes along here like this, intersects the curve somewhere else, flips over and it's over here. So this is 4G. Now, we won't look at it anymore, right? The formula for this is just mathematics to do with lines and the tangent of this curve. It's actually not very complicated. The point is that what we're doing is by multiplying G by various numbers, or adding it to itself, this point addition, we're moving around this curve, sort of seemingly at random, right? A bit like how we were moving around our clock face seemingly at random. So the nice thing is that if you're adding points together on an elliptic curve, you will always intersect only one other point, which means that you've never got a choice of two or three points where you could go. So that helps a lot when you're doing this. So if I give you a point on the curve here, and I say, question mark G, right? How many multiples of G is that? Don't know, any ideas? No idea at all. Right, it could be 50G, it could be 5 billion G. There's no way of knowing. That is our private number, and that's the thing we can't extract back out. Here, we couldn't get out A. If I give you A, G, that's our, I'm gonna capitalize it now, G plus G plus G plus G, A times, on this curve, I give you that point and ask you to tell me what the private variable was. No idea, you know. For a small curve, you might guess it after a few attempts. For a big curve, you're never going to guess it. Right? Or it's going to take you so long, you won't bother. So what elliptic curves do is literally a plug-in replacement for the mathematics, for the modular arithmetic mathematics involved in normal Diffie-Hellman. Bob will calculate BG, and their shared secret will end up being ABG. And it's very, very similar. Now, just to give you some idea, we also do this all modulo n, because why wouldn't you? No, because that's how the mathematics works. That's what we do. So in fact, it doesn't really look like a curve anymore. I'll show you a picture of one. So this is an example of an elliptic curve I just looked on the internet. Right? Modulo something like 460, something like this. It's some curve. I don't know what the parameters are. Now you can see that if this was a generator, the points are just going to dot around all over the place. Eventually, they'll go back to the start and cycle back round again, but not for a long, long time. So if I give you this point and tell you what was my private number, that's how it's secure. It's very hard to undo that. And in fact, it's very mathematically quite easy to calculate some multiple of g and move around, but it's very difficult to undo that process. That's the private part of elliptic curves.
You know what I'm going to ask you, though? Why? Why would you bother with this? This looks like it's adding unnecessary complication.
Yeah, well, so it is, in some sense, slightly more complicated, but actually, mathematically, it's much more efficient. So elliptic curves are a little bit harder to solve. This elliptic curve discrete logarithm problem, which is what we call it, is slightly harder to solve in some sense than the regular discrete logarithm problem, which means that elliptic curves can get away with shorter key sizes, and that just means less computation when you're calculating a to the g or b to the g. To give you an example, so let's imagine that I use a Diffie-Hellman key that's 3,000 bits long. I would get the same security from an elliptic curve where my prime n is only 256 bits long, which is much, much shorter. The maths is much easier to compute, it's much, much faster. So there is a strong tendency to use elliptic curves for that reason. If you've got to imagine, if you're a server performing these key exchanges all the time because people come into your shop or something like this, then that kind of saving is actually quite useful. It doesn't really matter if you're doing it on your home PC, but you know, that many, you might as well use it.
With the flip side of that question then,
yeah.
Is anyone still using the other way?
Yeah, so there are a few people who are a little bit suspicious of elliptic curves and certain elliptic curves. For example, the NIST P256 curve has its detractors because they're not absolutely sure where things like this A and B came from and so on. Okay, maybe. I mean, for what it's worth, big companies are also using that curve and they seem to be fine with it. Other curves are available. To give you an example, I've used a publicly available cryptography library to generate a couple of essentially equivalents to G to the A and AG, just so you can see the difference in the sort of size we're talking about here. If I run this Python script, we've established a generator and a large prime, and this prime is 2048 bits. So this is our A, and this is our G to the A mod N. And you can see, I mean, this will be slightly shorter, but the idea, you can see that they're quite long, approaching 2000 bits. Right? Yep. So that, on a fast machine, you can see it didn't take very long to compute, but it took a little time to compute. If I run the same thing using elliptic curve cryptography on the NIST P256 curve, we'll see it should be a lot shorter. There we go, right, much shorter. So this is a 256-bit number, much, much shorter. You can see our private key is actually a number because it's a number A, the number of times we've jumped around our elliptic curve. And this is our actual XY coordinate of our point on the curve. So you can see it's split in two. Here's the first part and then the second part here. So this is X and this is Y. What you would normally do in this kind of situation if you were deriving a key from this is scrap the Y and just use the X because it's long enough and secure enough. But that will depend on your situation. There are debates that are had over what curves are safe to use. A lot of people use the NIST P256 curve, but some people, other researchers, don't think that's secure because they've taken shortcuts on some of the parameters for efficiency reasons, and they're not sure where some of these parameters came from. And that isn't without precedent. There was a situation where an elliptic curve random number generator was found to essentially have a backdoor, right, which might be for a different video. So the X25519 curve is quite well regarded because they've gone to great lengths to demonstrate how they came up with their variables and why it's used. You know, if you're into cryptographic research, this is something that can concern you. If you're just using the web, probably don't worry about it.
The message "Hello, Computerphile" pop up. So it's getting the data of various things, and we see here, "Hello, computer file." We've been able to do this by accessing a value that we shouldn't be able to access. This code, this if statement, should stop us being able to access this past the end of this array.